Alrighty guys, what's going on? Linky here, and welcome to another video. Today we are going to be talking about Pokemon yet again, and it's going to be my review of the Isle of Amor DLC, part one of the DLC package that Game Freak announced back in January. Now we've had the Isle of Amor DLC downloaded and we've been playing it, I'm sure you have as have I, for the last 2 weeks or so, and now that I've played through the story, experienced the world they've given us, captured and raised some of the returning and new Pokemon that they've given us, I want to do a full review basically of my thoughts of the DLC and a lot of what I think moving forward Game Freak is going to take from the DLC and incorporate into future games, maybe future DLC. We'll see. So let's jump right into it. So first off, I want to talk about the price. Now for $30, you get both expansions that are coming in this set. You get the Isle of Amor, which we got a couple weeks ago, and then you get the Crown Tundra later this fall, winter. Basically meaning each of these pieces individually is about $15. And for $15, I think they delivered. I would have paid $20, $25 for the Isle of Amor alone, and when you split it up and make it $15 each, I think this was a bargain. The content that we got in this was very good. We got a massive list of returning Pokemon from the previous seven generations. We got new legendary Pokemon and evolutions for those. We got the addition of Pokemon following you in this new area. We got new side quests and new story content. And we also got a whole host of new moves, items, and clothing options for the character that we never got in the original game. All of that combined, I thought the price was worth it. I know I saw a lot of people on Twitter discussing whether or not they felt that the package overall was worth the price. Personally, I thought it did. But also keep in mind that I thought Sword and Shield were complete games when they first came out. So all of this is new to me. It's not like I felt Isle of Amor and Crown Tundra should have been included in the original package, like I think a minority of fans thought as well. An interesting thing is there was a purchase bonus if you bought it early, and it was basically Leon's outfit. And we have yet to get that, so I'm not sure when that's happening. I don't think that's been available to us yet, but if it is, maybe I'll make a fix to this and I won't mention it. But everything we've pretty much gotten. Now, one of the most important things to talk about in this update is the returning Pokemon that I mentioned before. We got over 100 returning Pokemon, a lot from Generation 1, Generation 2, 3, 4, a lot from 5, and then 6 and 7. 6 and 7 had some standouts. Rockruff and Lycanroc are back. Sandygast, Palossand, to my favorite Pokemon, Amoongus, which is great for competitive, is also back. There's a lot of good ones. Crocodile, a lot of standouts in this list. Poliwrath, Politoed, Alakazam, Magneton and Magnezone, Exeggutor, Licky, Kingdra, all these different Pokemon from previous generations are now back, and you can feel it. The amount of Pokemon options that we have now in this expansion for the entire game, it feels a lot more sizable. For the first couple months of Sword and Shield, I always felt that it was an appropriate number of Pokemon, but now I think you're starting to feel the weight of all the generations back again that I really think was lacking in the original game. You don't feel as restricted as I used to. The way they incorporated the Pokedex in this game, I think, or in this expansion rather, I felt could have been better. I think they should have given you a separate view of it as the Isle of Amor decks, but there's just some funny ordering they did with this, decisions of how to code it. They don't add to your total when you save the game and when you look at your progress. There's a couple weird exclusions and implementations here that I would have changed. But overall, the Pokedex is good. It's nice that they give us a separate one for the Isle of Amor, even though I would have done it differently. One of the other things that's interesting is that we got no new Galarian forms. We got Galarian Slowpoke and Galarian Slowbro, and then in Crown Tundra, we're going to get Galarian Slowking. But we didn't get any new ones for old Pokemon. I felt that was kind of a misstep. I mean, we got no new G-Max forms besides the Kanto starters and Urshifu. And we got, and the Galarian starters, of course. But we got nobody other G-Maxes or any new Galarian forms. And I personally, if I was presenting this as a package to somebody, that's something I would have kept secret. I would have marketed it. But I would have had it in there as like an extra thing that fans would have seen when they played it. Something they held back. And honestly, one of the only things they held back from us is another new addition to Sword and Shield, which is Pokemon following you again. Now, some of them are slow, some of them are a little buggy, and you can tell I almost feel like it was sort of like a last minute thing that they decided to include. But I will defend the way the Pokemon move on one part. It feels really natural. Like, certain Pokemon move the way you expect them to, and whether or not that's very slow or very fast, it feels alive in a way. Like, Pokemon are not going to follow you like they did in Heart Gold and Soul Silver if this was realistic. That's not realistic. And they're all sized properly. Wailord. And maybe Eternatus. But the Pokemon are sized very well, and they move like you would expect them to move, and I thought that was very good. Obviously, I think the best interpretation of Pokemon following you that we've seen in the entire series is still Let's Go Pikachu and Eevee, even more so than Heart Gold and Soul Silver, the way they implemented some of them that you ride on, some of them that you hold on to, like Snorlax. This is a close second. I think they did a good job with it. So new Pokemon, while we didn't get Galarian forms and G-Maxes any more than they previously announced, I thought all the returning ones are good, and I thought following you was also really good. Now I want to talk about the characters and storyline. We got Mustard and his dojo, learning how to control Kubfu, and eventually Urshifu taking on the Two Towers. I thought it was very good. I thought Mustard was a standout character in this DLC. I love his backstory of him being a former Galarian champion, training Leon. All of that was really good. Basically getting the knowledge that when he presents you with the two Kanto starters that you can pick after you complete it, that Leon picked Charmander. There's a lot of good Galar region lore presented in this DLC, and I think that's fantastic. The rival characters, Clara and the other guy, I honestly don't remember his name right now. Clara and that guy. They're hit or miss. I mean, I liked that we got a jerk rival character in this. We don't really see those as much anymore, which is unfortunate. Their personalities, for me at least, were a little annoying. I still can't remember the psychic guy's name, and I would look it up, but it's not worth it. They were really good. They were fine. I didn't like they had them cheat at the end. That kind of ruined it for me. I felt like maybe when you bring a character down by trying to meddle like that, it overall just decreases the character in terms of how I judge it. But the designs were good. Their battle themes were really good. Mustard's battle theme was very good as well. The dojo storyline was very good. How Hop comes in. I always forget him and How. Is it How or is it Hop? It's Gen 7 and Gen 8. It's one of the two. How he comes in and you kind of travel with him after the main bulk of the story, and then you get the second half where eventually you battle Mustard. I thought that was really good too, how they bring him back. It's the execution of the story that we get is quality. Maybe I would have preferred it to be a little bit longer. You can get around 2.5 hours of gameplay out of it. I would have preferred 3 to 4, and hopefully that's what we see with Crown Tundra, which by all accounts seems to be an even meatier piece of content than this, which is fantastic. So we'll see how that ends up turning out. But overall, the story I thought was very good. I thought it was solid, adds a lot of lore. It was good. The next thing that we got sort of was in line with this, but even if you didn't have the DLC, you can still take part. And it was a Zeraora raid event. So it basically, the Pokemon Company tasked us with defeating 1 million Zeraora raids. And if we did that through Pokemon Home, we would have access to a shiny Zeraora, which is this beautiful white color. We did it. We hit like 1,400,000 within like a week and a half. And yesterday, when I'm recording this video, I'm recording this on a Tuesday, June 30th. But yesterday, he officially got revealed, or midnight last night. Today, he got officially released. Downloaded him. He's great. Got a great moveset. Great items. And I wanted to make a point of this in the video, that this is a really good way, I feel, of doing event Pokemon and giving us to them in the future. Challenges, raids, getting the community involved. I think that's a solid way to do it. It's better than just releasing a mythical on Mystery Gift. I hope there is some sort of event for Zarud when he gets announced with his movie. It's the new monkey Pokemon that got the new mythical monkey Pokemon that got revealed a couple months ago. I really hope they do something for him too. This is a great way to do mythicals. It's fun. It's engaging. It gets the community involved, and it's a reward. It's something, and you get some cool other items as well from doing the raid. He's got some really good raid drops. I don't know if Zeraora is running anymore. If he is, and you haven't done it, even though shiny Zeraora is now available to us, if you're looking to get some items for Sword and Shield, jump into that raid. They drop really good stuff. And this is a great thing that the Pokemon Company is doing. Raids overall have been a huge highlight for Gen 8 for me. I think it's great. If you're part of the community, you knew that Serebii which is a great Pokemon website. The guy who runs Serebii organized community raid hours every week. And raids are just great. And I love that they're doing them to introduce mythical Pokemon into the game and allow us to catch some of these guys. So I think overall, what we've seen from Isle of Amor, what we've seen from the events that have been coming with it have been really good. The designs for the new forms we did get, going back to that for a minute, Gigantamax Galar starters, the two other Gigantamax Kanto starters, all of them are really good. Again, they're great. They're solid designs. Inteleon's is really cool, how he's at the top of a sniper tower. Really good stuff. I am a big fan of a lot of it. So overall, while I personally am still more excited for what we're getting with Crown Tundra, which there will be Crown Tundra content in the coming months on this channel, discussing it, giving my thoughts. And that's been the one I was more excited for overall, just because I felt it was going to add more to the lore. And I love the environment a lot more than a beach setting, because we don't see a lot of snowy settings in Pokemon. I thought it was really solid. Isle of Amor, solid 8 out of 10 in my opinion. Great expansion, well worth the price so far, and I'm excited to see what we get moving forward with DLC. The last thing I wanted to hit on is the design of this place, this open world, open air map that we got, I hope is the future of Pokemon games. I think that this is how Diamond and Pearl remakes hopefully will look, how Generation 9 will eventually look. This is the way Game Freak needs to move. We're seeing subtle movements towards it over the original Sword and Shield, and now this, it's perfect. It's a great natural step for the series, and I hope they continue to go down this route because I think it'll make Pokemon games better. The exploration is great. The interaction with the Pokemon is great. Pokemon following you in this open air map is great. This is what you need to do in the future, Game Freak. This is how you need to move forward. So I'm very excited for the future of Pokemon after seeing how they rolled out Isle of Amor, and I hope you guys are as well. Anyway, I've rambled on for far too long. It's been about 12 minutes by now. I hope you all enjoyed today's video. Apologies that videos have been slow as New York has been moving to reopen after COVID. I know that the rest of the country is experiencing a spike, sadly, right now, but we're doing very well here. And going back to work recently, trying to kind of get a life again after being locked inside for months, it's slowed down video production, so hopefully that'll be ramping back up in the coming weeks. And I'm glad you guys are still around to watch. New video coming out soon. Hope you all enjoyed. I have been Linky, and we'll see you all in the next video. Peace out.